enjoy a seat at the table and good company, where great conversations and meaningful discussions happen.
Welcome to And Good Company. I'm Sarah Fiedelholtz. We all know a great dinner party isn't really about the food. It's about the people seated around the table engaging in lively discussions. And Good Company gives you a seat at the table to enjoy smart and engaging conversations as they happen. I am pleased to be in the company of Rachel Blakeman, the director of the Community Research Institute at Purdue University Fort Wayne. Welcome.
Hello.
So, first, why don't you tell me a little bit about the Community Research Institute and what it does.
Excellent. Thank you, Sarah. First of all, thank you for having me on the show.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
Happy to share some information about the work that we're doing. So CRI has been in existence since 1987. We do contract-based research and analysis. So that means that companies, nonprofits, government hire CRI. And what I like to say is that we help leaders make informed decisions. So what we often do with that is doing research. Typically, we don't do our own research. We're using third-party research, putting it into context. Or also, I've really found a sweet spot with project management, grant administration, grant writing. So we've expanded into that as well.
And you've also said that you found a sweet spot for the type of organizations and entities you work with.
Yeah, so when I came on board, historically, CRI had been working in economic development and workforce development. We still do some of that work, but really I'm doing a lot of work these days with nonprofit organizations, often with grant funding. So I'd like to, if you are a CRI client, thank you very much. We've enjoyed working together, and I hope we have the opportunity to work with more folks in the future.
And so some of the clients and people that you've recently, you have a longstanding relation with Lutheran.
With the Lutheran Foundation,
right.
Yes.
And then you did a big project or initiative with United Way.
Yes, United Way of Allen County.
And then you actually did like a, in those you really do, you really do original research, mm-hmm. where with the, you did a big project for the Community Foundation Women's Fund, where you sort of looked at existing data.
Well, so actually the United Way project and the Community Foundation project actually looked very similar. So looking at third party data, so where can we get information, the American Community Survey from the U.S. Census Bureau, information from a variety of sources, such as the Indiana Department of Education, all of that. And then what we did for both of those projects was to do a survey of people who live in Allen County. For the Women's Fund, it was women living in Allen County. For the United Way, it was adults living in Allen County. And we used that to find information that we did not have anywhere else. What I like to think about is that often these third-party sources, so whether it be Bureau of Labor Statistics, the CDC, often are very good at telling us what or who, but they're often very poor at telling us why.
Right.
And so then we use the opportunity to do these random sample surveys. So it's not just, we don't put a survey link online and anybody wants to take it. We actually hire a company. We've been using SurveyUSA. I'd like to give a shout out to Andy Downs at the Mike Downs Center for Indiana Politics on the Purdue Fort Wayne campus, who's helped with these projects. And so we do those, we hire a company to do the survey so that way we're getting a reliable sample. Both projects actually oversampled rural residents and urban residents. We know that if we just leave it to the devices of the population, we know that white suburban women, middle-aged people like myself, are very good at taking surveys. But as lovely as my demographic is, we're not the end-all be-all.
Right.
So we want to make sure that we're representing the full diversity of Allen County. And so I give credit to both of those clients for putting that extra work and the extra resources into that to be able to reflect the true diversity of Allen County.
And I also wonder, I remember from my days of statistics, you have to have, you know, a good statistical sample. Because I always wonder when they talk about, like, they put up the all-in Allen County a plan for people to comment on, or when they were doing like the Southeast and they get, you know, 50 people to comment. To me, that's not really going out in the community. So when you think about what is the minimum number of surveys, like answer, do you feel you have to have to get a comprehensive, I mean, granted, you're going to look at demographics and representation by all different you know, entities, but is there like a magic number?
Yeah, I mean, so the larger your sample, the more answers you get, the better you are.
Right.
And so what you're looking at, though, is we can, both of those projects had 400 responses.
And is that considered a good?
Yeah, I mean, so it gives you a representative sample for the overall population. Once you start to get to narrower, so if you want to say, I want to look at women 18 to 34 who are non-white, I'm going to have a limited sample in that. So that's going to mean that those answers are going to be, what I like to talk about is that those are how the respondents answered. I'm
right.
not going to say that that may represent the larger community, but it's also often we're talking about information we have no other data for.
Right.
So it gives us a starting point to have that conversation. So I've got another project that I'm talking to a potential client on, and we're saying, okay, how many, we might need to sample a larger segment because of the questions that they need to ask.
Right, because so, you can't extrapolate.
Right, because if I want to have it where I need to get some certain subgroups within the population, I'm going to have to talk to more people.
Right.
So surveys are calculated on a cost of the number of questions and the number of people.
Right.
So sometimes it may be a situation where we're going to narrow the questions and talk to more people. There's always more questions we want to ask than resources available, but it's still really interesting to get this because of the fact that we put the effort into making it a random sample, not just putting it online for anyone who wants
right.
to take. There's reasons to do those convenient samples. I've done them for a project, and I'm confident I'll do those again because sometimes the client doesn't have the resources, or
right.
we're okay with that.
Right.
So it depends on the purposes of the project.
Right. And so the other thing that, you know, obviously surveys are similar to polls. So we've all experienced in two elections what happens with polls and how the issues with surveys being conducted. So I think people have a good understanding of surveys. But we're also in a time when everything is like data crazy. You know, everybody talks about collecting data and having data and sources for data. And I wanted to talk to you about that and how you evaluate the data sources, because like you and I was asking when we sort of talked before about, you know, like, well, Wallet Hub or the, you know, USA Today says the best, the fittest cities, or what the, you know, where Fort Wayne ranked in terms of quality of place. And you were sort of saying that you have to, it's just as important about what data you're looking to collect, where you go for those sources. So talk a little bit about data itself and the types of sources and where, what are the good resources that you really use?
Sure, thank you. So CRI's preference at any point is always to use publicly available data, preferably from government sources. And the reason why I say that is for the fact that one, they have the typically the most comprehensive data. So the example I always like to use, and you and I talked about this, was the U-Haul survey. So U-Haul at the end of every year likes to tell us where the places that people moved from and to.
Right.
And that's an excellent information point for the people who used U-Haul.
Right.
It doesn't tell me comprehensively everybody.
Right.
Now, one of the advantages of those sources is that U-Haul sends that out at the end of December, very beginning of January. I have to wait for Census Bureau data well into the next year, but the comprehensive nature of it, the fact that they don't have an agenda. Sometimes I look at these, I'm like, well, of course, this is a liberal think tank, so they're going to come up, they're going to see the data through a very particular lens.
Right.
Or a conservative lens, it doesn't matter what it is. Whereas the Bureau of Labor Statistics has no agenda
right.
to try to drive wages up or down. They're simply going to report from the Quarterly Census of Employment and Wages, QCEW, a favorite data source of mine that tells me how many jobs and what people got paid. Incredibly comprehensive in the nature of how mm-hmm. that data is collected. It comes from the states, it comes from the unemployment insurance
right.
information, and so what it means, though, is that there's a lag time. There is a distance. So I have lots of folks who are asking me right now, like, tell me about what's happened during the pandemic. And I'm like, excellent question. I would be happy to tell you once I get that information.
Right.
I'm not going to have the first information from the U.S. Census Bureau, from the American Community Survey, it's the long form. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to have that information until September. So right now we're kind of making some good guesses, but I've got no information.
Right.
So we're starting to get 2020 data. It'll be from now until, frankly, the end of the year, into December, before we start to see the full piece of information. So I think that there's an expectation of real-time data from these sources. And quite honestly, not really. We get some good monthly data from the state of Indiana. So
for unemployment, right?
Unemployment is the one that everyone is familiar with. Another one that I've used in the past year to understand what's happening with income at the state level and at the county level within the state has actually been SNAP, Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, which was formerly food stamps. So FSSA, the Family and Social Services Administration, reports monthly numbers about the number of people receiving SNAP, the amount of money they're receiving from SNAP. So we get really good information. So the SNAP benefits were actually a proxy that I used for the United Way project and for another project to understand what was happening at a local level.
In terms of food insecurity.
Well, and also income.
Okay.
So it is...
Because it is income-based.
Right, it's income-based. So for low-income individuals, and so it gave me a really good proxy to understand what was happening. Food stamps or SNAP is a program that's well used.
Right.
Not a lot of thresholds to get into it. So it can give me a sense. So we saw last year with the SNAP data that we saw that it spiked into May. It leveled off in the summer, started to go down in September, but it still stayed high.
Right.
So it showed us something about what was happening at the income level in a way that I had no other data to use. So so often we have to be thinking about how can we get the data that is helping us to understand what is currently happening. And other times we just have to be patient.
And then also from the SNAP data, you would also then be able, because they know where the people live, which zip codes, so you actually then could use that to build where truly there are these pockets, right?
Well, so the data that we have from the state that's released on the public level that I've received has been at the county level. I have not looked at a sub-county level.
Okay.
We recognize from a project that actually Sierra did a few years ago, we did with the St. Joe Community Health Foundation, the Vulnerable Populations Report. We looked at things based on zip code. What we can anticipate that we will see in the data as it starts to come out is that the pandemic amplified the inequities and the disparities. It didn't necessarily create new ones. So for many of us, depending on where you're at, so for myself, I got to work from home.
Right.
I've been working from home since March of 2020. And so in many ways, people like myself have either stayed the same or become economically advantaged. I didn't have to travel to work. I wasn't eating out for lunch.
You didn't have to buy clothes.
Right, exactly. And so for many folks who were white-collar workers, knowledge workers who were able to work from home, they actually may have found themselves economically advantaged.
Plus, those are ones that are more likely to have 401ks and invest in the market and also own homes.
Right, exactly. So the market structure has rewarded a very particular class of workers in the past year. Now, if you are somebody who needs to, you can't do your job from home.
Right, which we saw with the first line workers, a lot of those were low income jobs.
Right. So if you work in a restaurant, you work in a hotel,
hospital,
you are a hairstylist, so you have to do, clinical workers obviously continued to show up, our healthcare workers, and kudos to them for all the work that they did, but they were in, so if I think about the person who cuts my hair, he could not work from home because he was not allowed to be open for business. And so those are the kinds of workers then that the economy disadvantaged. And so for people who were saying, okay, you know what? I mean, I know I did not go as often to my salon. And there are many other things like that where people, the economy advantaged some and disadvantaged mm-hmm. others. Mm-hmm. And for those who, let's say that you worked as a housekeeper at a hotel, those are not high income jobs, often who were economically vulnerable before the pandemic hit. and then have found themselves even more vulnerable through this past year.
Right. And so I know that the data from the 2020 census is very important, and it's going to create a lot of, you know, shifts and things in terms of representation and district lines and all kinds of things. But you, it was funny because you said to me, you don't deal in predictions, you deal in facts and numbers. But you are able to sort of give us a sort of a check-in of the demographics and status of where we are in terms of Fort Wayne. And what I thought was also really interesting is when you provide some the data, you look at local, and then you look at Fort Wayne within the context of the state of Indiana, and then within the context of the nation. Mm-hmm. So I think that that was really interesting, because it's not just enough to be able to say something about Fort Wayne. You need to be able to compare it, especially in terms of how that relates to whatever the national figures are. So I thought that that's really important to how you look at the data. And I know you also talked about, in terms of your data sources, you also look at the methodology. So that's why, like with SNAP, the methodology, there isn't really, it's a sort of the how they run the program. So there's no methodology of how they collected the data or not. So so I just want to have a check-in based on, you know, because it's very, you know, some people say that Hispanics is the fastest growing demographic in the country, and that, you know, Fort Wayne is still 70% white, but the shift, you know, that they're predicting in, you know, 30 years, whites will not be the, you know, major, they'll become a minority population. So I'm curious, just to give us sort of some demographic overview of Fort Wayne.
Yeah, so Fort Wayne, so the data that I've been looking at has actually been primarily on the county level. So there are, the county is often the unit that I can get the most data on. Sometimes there's city level data. Part of it is also my clients. So the two big projects that I've recently done for the United Way and for the Community Foundation wanted to look at Allen County level data. So that's what we did. We looked at Allen County.
And what is the total do you know the total population for, like, for Fort Wayne? It's like 250,000, but the whole, what they consider, I guess, the major metropolitan area, that I guess would be the county, right?
No, so this is where it gets complicated. Okay. So the city of Fort Wayne, most people who live in Allen County live within the city of Fort Wayne.
Okay.
And I just looked at this the other day, and I should remember this because I literally typed it up. But it's something like 275,000-ish.
Yeah.
So then in 2000...
And that's growing.
Yeah.
Somewhat. Yeah.
Right. I mean, so Fort Wayne and Allen County have a very envious birth rate. We have more people being born every year than people dying. So that means natural increase. If we do nothing else, at least for the foreseeable future, more people are getting born.
We're replacing
born.
Our population. Which
we're
is,
actually growing.
Which is not what the case is across the
right.
nation at all.
But
we are in a population replacement deficit.
Well, I'm not sure if I would go that far, but we have... But so what we know is, though, that our birth rate has remained relatively steady, or the number of births every year has remained steady. What we do see is that the number of deaths each year is starting to creep up. That's to be expected. So if we think about it, that the oldest baby boomers, my mother being one of them, so I always know, are turning 75 this
right.
year. So as I've reminded my mother, that they're not making any more baby boomers.
Right.
And so that is, so we are going to see the number of deaths naturally increase just because of the population
right
structure.
Just as we saw over the last 20 years the naturally the number of people who were applying for Social Security or,
right exactly
because that demographic group of baby boomers was 76 million.
Right.
So they're
exactly.
going through the system.
Right. Right, exactly. So they're going through natural age transition.
Right.
So we're seeing then that the number of deaths each year is going to naturally increase because of the population structure.
And that's true across the board.
Yeah, and okay. so, but we have enjoyed a relatively high birth rate. So that has been advantaged. We have also seen recently more people moving in than moving out. And for a while the Census Bureau tracks things in two different ways. They track it from international migration and domestic migration. So international migration is you have arrived to this location from a foreign country.
Right.
Largely what we were seeing with that was the immigrant and refugee population. It also counts if you're a student, if your child has come back from a study abroad, they are counted as an international migrant.
Oh. Even though they live here.
Right, but they're coming okay. back. So if let's say they had been away right. doing a study abroad in France for a year, that would be an international migration. Not a right. large segment, but one.
Do they count also those that get H-1 visas for jobs that only?
Yeah, so it's any international migrants.
Okay.
So it doesn't matter about legal status. I actually have no data from the U.S. Census Bureau about immigrants without citizenship and their legal status.
Right.
Don't have
it. Because we don't
so
ask
they don't,
that.
So they don't ask it, right. so I don't know. So then what we talk about then is domestic migration.
Okay.
So that means that you're already living in the United States and you have moved here to Allen County.
Okay.
And so when we can think about that is the way I like to position that is voting with your feet. So are we voting with your feet to come into Allen County
right.
or are you voting with your feet to leave Allen
okay.
County? For a number of years, we were very strong on people voting with their feet to leave Allen
okay.
County. In the past 2-3 years, we have started to see a positive trend.
But it's very, very small. I mean, it's not...
Well, it's not huge, but also we have a situation right now that migration is actually very low. People
right.
aren't moving
right.
like they did
no.
20, 30
they
years
ago. They say this
ago.
Is like a stuck generation.
Yeah, and yeah. so there's a... I don't think anybody has a solid reason as to why that is
right.
happening. I've heard different reasons for that.
But well, when you and I talked about it, you know, before the pandemic, we sort of were talking about the idea of why people typically move.
Mm-hmm.
They typically move for family or a job.
Mm-hmm.
So if a job is only going to pay you, and normally you would move because you would get a bump, but let's say the bump is $25,000, you would typically think that that was a good enough bump. But most companies aren't moving you. So if you add in the cost of the move, which trust me, I can tell you, will eat up a good part of that. And then if you're moving from an area where your family is, who helped you with childcare, and then you're moving somewhere else where you're gonna have to pay for it, there goes that $25,000. So you have to start evaluating, do you want more where, you know, to stay where your family is, or you make the decision you're going to move so that wherever you're living, you are paying more for childcare. But if you move closer to family, you won't have that expense.
Right. So what we know about the mobility of workers is actually it largely depends on their skill and education level. So the more education a person has had, the more likely they are to relocate. And so that means that then we're looking at college educated workers.
Right.
So if you are somebody who ended your education with your high school diploma, perhaps you've gone on to get a certificate or a certification. So you have some additional skills, but you're very likely to stay where you are at. So
right.
the welders that we are generating here, getting certifications in welding, they are very likely to stay where they are. We also see that with actually at the bachelor's degree level for our local institutions, my employer included, that we see actually our local educational institutions create the workforce that we need here locally. Now, obviously, I'm thinking of friends of mine who graduated from what was then IPFW who live in the Bay Area.
Right.
It's not exclusive, but it's definitely...
But the large majority.
Right, exactly. So we know that we can move, that tends to be where people move.
And where, and you know, because also like the Northeast Indiana Regional Partnership did a whole initiative to try to get people from, they targeted 4 cities that they thought would have an opportunity to move here. When you see people moving into Allen County, is it really that they're just moving from other regions or rural areas in Indiana, or are we seeing it more that they really are coming from places like Austin or Chicago or, you know?
Yeah, I haven't looked at the data recently. I do know that that is actually tracked, and thank you to the IRS for that information. So we do know something about it. It's one of those things where I think that's often data that's actually like often a couple years behind. So
okay.
I have not looked at it recently to know. But we do know that you have some large employers that are likely to bring in folks from out of state. So we look at Sweetwater.
Right.
We look at Parkview.
Right.
We know that some years, because of the way that GM does its hiring and its transfers, so sometimes we know that we're going to get a spike of folks from a GM plant that closed out of state. Obviously, we hit the jackpot of building building pickup trucks.
Right.
So we're going to have workers who are going to be coming mm-hmm. in from other locations. So we know some of those pieces. So it really, if we think about it, of a lot of folks are either going to move back to Fort Wayne, Allen County, Northeast Indiana, because of those family ties.
Right, that's like that boomerang, that's what they call that.
Right, exactly. So they may be a situation where, gosh, I would like to be closer to my aging right. parents. I would like my kids to be able to see their grandparents. Right. I really like being
Or
close.
During the pandemic, you had a lot of kids who had to move home because of situations, and then they're staying, you know.
Right, exactly. So I think that when we think about, because I get questions about like, well, are we going to be a Zoom town? Well, no, we're not going to be a Zoom town. Let's be candid about
right.
that. I just saw something yesterday on the New York Times talking about how the pull of the Bay Area is starting to come back.
Right.
Of tech workers who had left, who are finding themselves wanting to go back. How many tech workers we arrived here during that? We don't. Again,
right.
I don't have any data.
Right.
So we have limited information.
But let's look at also the issue like that we talked about, sort of the types of jobs that Indiana and Allen County are sort of focused on bringing or developing, and what that means in terms of the overall demographic mix, including education, because levels. Because if we don't have certain jobs that require a bachelor's degree, are we then going to be able to increase? Because I think now I don't even think we have 50%. Of the population have bachelor's degrees.
Yeah, I'm like, no place does.
Right. And
no
right.
place
I
in
think,
the United
I
States.
I think the highest we talked about was Massachusetts, which is what, 33?
44. It's like 40
okay.
something.
Okay. So, but let's talk, tell me about how that, what the initiatives and sort of things that we hear about within Indiana and Allen County, and sort of what that means to impact the demographics.
Yeah, so when we look at it on a regional level, manufacturing is our largest employer, has the most number of people working in manufacturing. When we think about manufacturing here in Northeast Indiana, those are largely production jobs. We're making the stuff
right.
here.
Very few are doing the research and development.
There's limited. You will see that probably the most in Kosciuszko County, because they have the full set of infrastructure. And I've done some work in Kosciuszko County.
And they're
County.
Known as, that's in the orthopedic capital.
Yeah, right. So they do orthopedic right. medical devices.
Or you have some like Fort Wayne Metals that is related to the medical device.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they do R&D and things like
right.
that.
Right. I mean, so also, like, we're the headquarters of Steel Dynamics
right.
here in Fort Wayne. I mean, so we have some. But unfortunately, Fort Wayne and Allen County has done a par excellence job of having corporate headquarters and R&D jobs leave. So we used to have Navistar, that's gone. Dana Corporation
right.
production, but not the R&D
right.
function anymore. We lost Lincoln's corporate headquarters. We still have a large number of people. And so that's the reason why when we were talking a year ago about Do It Best Corporation and Electric Works, those corporate headquarters jobs are incredibly valuable.
Because those are more require BAs and above, they have a higher income.
Right, and they also, so those are some of the key measures that we can use, but they
okay.
also provide a different level of value of having that corporate leadership. So it is the decision to invest in Fort Wayne. If you want to have, if you're at a corporate headquarters, you want your people to be living in a vibrant community. So that means that you may either as a corporation or as a private individual have philanthropic giving that improves the quality of life
right.
here. So we can think about some of the local philanthropists.
Well, like Sweetwater, and that's really why I know Scott Glaze, and that's partly why he created, like when he originally started working downtown and created J.K. O'Donnell's, was because he felt when he had people coming here, you know, that they needed things to do, and then he thought, you know, recognized the need for his company would benefit if he was got involved in the development of quality of place and things like that.
Right, exactly. So you're going to see those things. So when we think about it, so manufacturing is our largest our largest employer.
And then second is what?
Healthcare.
And then third is our schools, right?
Probably. I haven't looked at it
okay.
recently,
yeah.
but I know that manufacturing, when we look at, I tend
okay.
to look at private sector jobs.
Okay.
Public sector jobs kind of exist, but I focus our energies here at CRI on the private sector, because
okay.
I believe that the private sector jobs are the gas pedal that we can push to increase wages. When we look at the public sector jobs, those often have constraints beyond what we are interested in talking about. So when I think about like how do we want to increase per capita personal income, how do we want to increase wages, we want to be looking at the private sector.
Okay.
So we have those jobs. Those are the drivers. So when we think about it, there is an immediate need for production workers and skilled production workers, and also unskilled. We have we have a need for both, but so we're looking at that.
But talk about that idea, though, that those jobs that are production workers or out of factory are not necessarily secure.
Oh, absolutely.
Jobs. So talk about that and that how that implication.
So manufacturing has done two things very well. One, it has automated. So automation removes people. Now, I will also be clear that automation has some advantages.
Right.
I appreciate the fact that my car was painted by robots. That meant that workers were not exposed to it. There is a precision that robots get. So it's not entirely bad. But it also then means that you're going to need somebody who knows how to work on robots and program robots.
Engineers or...
And high-skilled tech workers and things like that. But there are fewer of those than you need to have. Then also the other thing that manufacturing does really well, which is to find the cheapest way to make things. And often that means relocating those jobs to lower wage locations, whether that be elsewhere in the United States or to Mexico or to overseas.
Right, just like what happened with Vera Bradley and now is happening with Matilda Jane. I mean, you know, they...
U.S. wages are expensive.
Right.
And so in order to keep a competitive product, you have to be thinking about those things. Now, GM is advantaged in the fact that they can build $60,000 pickup trucks and somebody wants to buy those.
Right.
So there are lots of factors going on here. So over time, manufacturing, we may actually still make a lot of things. I don't think that we are at risk of losing a great amount of our actual production. If anything, the share of GDP to manufacturing has gone up over time, but the number of people working in manufacturing has
declined. Okay.
So I like to think of manufacturing as a short-term asset and a long-term liability. When we think about the jobs that are being created nationally, they are going to people with bachelor's degrees. What are we not doing? Getting enough people to go to college.
Right, because we sort of also, partly Indiana, and it seems like Allen County has also sort of taken the track that college isn't for everybody. And they also we saw the numbers recently that the number of high school graduates in Allen planning on going to college. So I think we've done too good of a job of saying college isn't for everybody, and also instead of saying what's the value of the college education, because it is shown with a BA degree, you are likely to make $1 million more over the course of your career than if you just have a high school diploma. But talk about also. So let's also look at, because it's interesting how all these things, you know, we could just weave from one to the other. Is the idea of the minimum wage for personal income, and then the idea of how that impacts, you talked about this local wage penalty, because then this goes into my whole personal, I'm on my soapbox about cost of living. Mm-hmm. So explain a little bit, because of the idea, and this is what aggravates me, is when the state or the region or Allen County, when they want to recruit a business or company to either expand here or relocate here. One of the things that they say is you don't have to pay your workers as much because our cost of living is lower. Mm-hmm. So first of all, I want you to dispel this myth about this idea that, because I believe, first of all, that your salary should not be dictated by cost of living. It should be dictated on the value that they feel you bring to the company and what that's worth for them. So talk about this local wage penalty, and then I really want to get into this whole idea of cost of living and what I believe is what people, I always say, is that everyone in Fort Wayne has drunk the Kool-Aid of believing about your lower cost of living.
Yeah, so what I've termed it is the Fort Wayne wage penalty. When we look at average wages, both the total wage and then wage by industry, I don't look at occupational wages for a variety of reasons. I tend to look at industry wages. We're looking at the private sector. And so we see that we're making somewhere between 80, 85 cents on the dollar.
And then women make even less than, you know, that.
Yeah, I mean, yes.
Yeah, so everybody, so we're all behind the eight ball, but then there's line us up, women, minorities, and then it really gets worse as mm-hmm. we go down.
Yeah, okay. And so we're starting out behind, so there is a wage penalty for working here. And we see, like I said, I see it across industries. I just ran the numbers for the United Way project. I believe the only industry that had above average wages was healthcare. Now, mind you, it's the largest sector, but and also the advantage was marginal.
Right, but that's also interesting because of the fact that the way healthcare is being managed now and doctors are becoming hospitalists and they don't have that unlimited cap, you know, when they were in private practice, they're paying them a flat, you know, salary, and now with also physician assistants and stuff. So it's interesting that you would
say,
but
most people in healthcare aren't necessarily providing direct clinical services.
True.
So we're counting the people who are doing billing, counting the people who are doing environmental services, janitorial work. I mean, so all of them, it's not just the clinical function of healthcare. So it's everybody in healthcare.
So that's important.
Yeah. So what we can see then is that we have that wage penalty. And I want to be clear about that when you're trying to attract workers here and you've got competing offers, it is very likely that your local offer is lower than what they're looking at from other cities.
Which is why to recruit talent like doctors or surgeons or C-suite level people, because you believe you don't have to pay as much, then if they get two offers, right?
I mean, obviously, I don't get to know what the CEOs are paying.
Right.
What I can say, though, is that when we look at it overall, there is going to be the possibility of a wage penalty overall. So then let's get to the cost of living.
Yeah, let's break this down.
So
first of all, I want you to explain, okay, because people, what is cost of living? And what is included in that? Mm-hmm. Because a lot of people, because when I start saying, is your Starbucks lower? Do you pay less for your insurance, your gas because you live here? They'll be like, no. So talk about the difference between cost of housing and cost of living. So let's first get that on the table and then you can dive into the numbers.
So the regional, what I like to use for a comparison for cost of living is from the U.S. Bureau of Economic Analysis. The latest numbers I have for them is 2019. I know you're waiting for the 2020 numbers. I'll be waiting for those.
Well, we'll have you back when you get those.
We'll get those in 2022 or at the end of this year. So what we know from that is that it's called the regional price parity. It's on the MSA level, so we're looking at that.
MSA is
Metropolitan Statistical Area. It is Allen and Whitley counties.
Okay.
So
they're put together.
Mm-hmm, they compose our MSA.
Okay.
So they look at three measures. The key one that they don't use is home ownership. So let's look at it from goods, rent, and then other services.
Okay.
So let's just take out home ownership. We'll talk about that in a little bit. So when I look at it, of the overall cost of my items here in Allen County, or the Fort Wayne MSA, is 88.1 cents. Okay, that is driven, that lower number is really driven by our lower rents. They pay 70.4 cents on the dollar. So if you own your house, let's just take that out. Or even if you rent, that's only a portion of your income. We hope it's less than 30%.
Although you and I talked about that, for a lot of people, they are paying more than 30%. Mm-hmm. And now although you told me it was not going to be sizable, but I believe that with all of the new development and like the apartment building I live in downtown, that is sort of going to give a bump in the average rent. But you said it wouldn't be significant enough.
Yeah. So if we look at it for the price parity for goods.
Okay. So goods would be
95.4 cents on the dollar.
So that's like for groceries. Is that for
all goods? So if I'm buying a car, if I'm buying furniture, if I'm buying groceries, goods. Material
not
items.
Services?
Services are separate.
Okay.
So when we look at services,
so what does that mean that we're 90, what did you say, we're 99 cents?
95.4 cents on the dollar.
So you're talking then that 4.6% less than mm-hmm. the rest of the country?
Yeah, so
is that really? I mean, is that really enough to say that our, for the cost of goods, that our cost of living in that sense is less?
Well, I mean, so it is. It's less than 100. So
okay, but it's not. But it's not like what I think people believe. Like it's like, you know, 70 cents.
Yeah. So it's.
And has that slowly creeped up for Fort Wayne over
if
the
anything,
last?
It's actually gone down.
Oh.
But by marginal numbers. So, and the cost of goods are actually, I've looked at this across the country, these are actually pretty steady, well into the like high 95, like 95-ish is kind of on the low end. Like you do not get a discount on goods across the country.
Right, but you, can you, when you look at cost of goods, right, does that take, that doesn't take into account tax rates, right? Like sales tax and stuff? No. So that would be one thing you would also have to add. And two, it doesn't take like, you know, obviously things in major cities like New York, San Francisco, are the cost of goods because how they have to bring them in and, you know.
It's the cost of goods overall. So they are looking at it for what it costs here.
Okay.
So we may get some advantage for the fact that we have a lot of goods that don't have to travel very far. So if it's coming from Chicago and it's coming here, I mean, so those are, I mean, obviously the cost of goods probably in Hawaii is going to be greater.
Right.
So then if we look at cost of services outside of rent, it's 91.4 cents on the dollar. So there's, again, a marginal saving.
But to me, it's marginal. It's not what I think the Kool-Aid makes you believe.
Right. I mean, so I will say this. When I looked at the housing numbers, I don't have these in front of me right now, but they're in the U.S., or they're in the United Way report. So we do actually have a lower cost of housing on average for our residents. It's median, and so it's some people are going to pay more, some people are going to pay less. So there is some cost savings, but again, it doesn't account for the wage penalty. So the wage penalty, so I need to be making at least 88 cents on the dollar in order to make it. I probably need to be making closer to like 92, 95 cents on the dollar.
Right.
So there is a wage penalty, and so the cost of living, we have given ourselves a false narrative for far too long about this. And as the cost of housing, especially for home ownership and for rent, is going up, you're going, the perceived value is starting to dissipate.
Okay, I want you to repeat this, because I'm telling you, this is all I've heard since when I started coming here, and the last year and a half that I've lived here, this belief that the cost of living and housing is so significantly lower that that's a draw to living here. Where, you know, in my perception, I was like, it's very expensive to me. I mean, typically your gas is more than, you know, the only thing that I found that was lower here was my car insurance coming from Florida, because they have very high. But say this again about this idea, about this false idea of the cost of living.
Yeah. So what we've done for many years is talked about how we are a very affordable place to live. And so, like, let's be clear, we are affordable when you're comparing us to coastal cities. So it is cheaper to live here than New York City or the Bay Area.
Right.
But what we can't do is convince ourselves that we're that much cheaper than much of the Midwest. There's not a huge margin. I mean, I think in most places, if you want to live cheap, you can live cheap anywhere.
Right. Well, I always say New York City is a great place to be when you're like just starting out and you have no money, because then you'll take advantage of every free thing they have, or where you're very, very wealthy. The hard part is when you are in that shrinking middle class,
right,
which I think would be true. But I also think that we can't compare, I mean, we really can't, in fairness. I mean, that's like apples to oranges comparing to New York City and San Francisco, because also, like in New York City, you do get a cost of living sort of bump in your salary, but then they also have city, state, and federal taxes, so you're also paying more in taxes. So, you know, but relative to other cities our size, or, you know, we're not that, we don't have such a significant.
Yeah, I mean, so the cost of housing has started to go up and pretty substantially.
Right.
I actually looked at the numbers to see what the median house price was from the sale of owner-occupied houses. And so 10 years ago, we were at about $105,000 for our median price. We're now up to over $180,000.
Right.
So, like, so obviously, if you own a house and you've owned it for some length of time, you probably are doing, you are in a more comfortable place than you were. But the like, ultimately, it comes down to the value proposition that we have sold ourselves on for far too long is not holding out to be as true as it may have been at one point. So, like I said, in any city, if you want to live cheap, Fort Wayne, you can do that.
Right.
But the overall value proposition, the numbers are shrinking. So we have not enjoyed the wage increases that other communities have had. So I ran the numbers for the United Way project. And so I compared the average wage of Allen County to the United States and to the state of Indiana.
Okay.
Let me find the numbers here. So this was really...
Should I give you a drum roll?
Well, so this was really interesting. Hold on, of course not.
I'll give you a drum roll.
So but what I'm looking at is that... Okay, so here it is.
Okay.
So overall, the average wage difference, so when I adjust for inflation from 2001 to 2019...
And put that in note, because after we have to talk about what's happening with inflation.
Mm-hmm, yeah. So... the United States average wage went up about $6,900.
Okay.
So
right.
There was a wage increase there.
And
the wage increase for the state of Indiana was about $3,000.
Right.
If you're going to the grocery store tonight, you might spend your entire wage increase
right.
of $95.
That's what I had to reread that when I saw that, because I was like, wait, there's got to be a typo. Why is it so low here? In terms of the wage, just because the nature of the jobs? And
When you watch thousands of good paying jobs leave and you replace it with $12 to $14 an hour jobs,
right.
So they were $80,000 a year jobs and they get replaced for $14
That's
an hour
enough.
Jobs.
Got it.
So, I mean, many of the jobs that we lost with Dana, with Navistar, with some of the losses, defense contracting goes up and down.
Right.
So when we've lost some of those jobs, those were really good paying jobs. Those were $50,000, $60,000, $70,000 a year jobs. They get replaced with $30,000 a year job. So in some ways, those wages were like losing two jobs
wow.
of wage worth,
wow.
of wage value.
Wow.
So we have not kept pace with this, and we have now fallen behind the state. We fell behind the state, I'm going to say like 2006, 2007. The
so
state
almost
of Indiana,
10 years, over 10 years
yeah,
ago.
So,
wow.
so yeah, so our wages are just not keeping up.
Wow. Okay. So, and then I just read there was this, I don't know if this is considered a good So I'm going to ask you, it's the fair market rent study that showed that that a worker with a federal minimum wage of $7.25, what they were showing is that no typical minimum wage worker can afford rent across the country.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the things that I also was wondering is with these crazy housing market that or even with rents going up, we are not providing housing that the type of workers with the type of incomes we have can afford. Is that true?
Well, so I would want to look more closely at the
okay.
numbers. So as of today, you've got $300 checks hitting, or $300 payments hitting bank accounts
right, but
for families. So that's with young children.
Okay, but the other thing is that, first of all, they're only getting that through the end of the year, and it really, they're still, it's not like extra money, it's just they got the payments earlier, so they're going to get less on their taxes.
Right. So
right?
the question is, how do you want to be paid?
Right. So, but it doesn't really like it, they make it sound like everybody's getting all this extra money. It's just when you're getting it. It's
yeah. Except when you have to pay your monthly rent.
Right. Okay.
Do you want to wait until you get the big check at the end, or do
right.
you want to keep yourself from
right.
being evicted?
Right.
Let's be clear.
Okay. Right.
So
there
say,
is, but the way that the government makes it sound is like they're giving everybody all this extra money, and they're really not. It's just how they're, when they're giving it to you. Also, that's when they did, like when they gave us those under Bush, when we got those stimulus checks, that was real extra money, like
mm-hmm.
everybody got. This is not, I mean, it's just putting more money in your pocket now, so you have to sort of stealing, you know, pay Paul, steal money.
Yeah, but you're still getting income.
Okay.
And so, I mean, if you've got to make month,
right.
you got to make your
right.
your check, you got to write a check for rent
right.
on August 1, you're certainly happy to see those $300 extra dollars right
okay.
now, because that check back, like in January, is not going to pay your rent this month.
Right, and that right if you're on the
so.
But now let's also talk about the inflation,
mm-hmm.
because we're seeing that. Inflation is up a record 7.3%, I guess, and that's the largest 12-month increase since the government began the current series of tracking these prices since 2010. Now, you actually explained to me that we want some inflation.
Yeah, absolutely.
So explain what's happening with inflation and why it's good.
Okay. So I think often when like you're sort of like a high school student learning about inflation and economics, or maybe in college, and you're like, well, deflation sounds like such a good idea. I can buy more
right.
with each dollar. Well,
right.
that's actually not what we want to happen. As an economic policy matter, we want to go ahead and we want to actually see inflation. So the goal of the Federal Reserve, who sets monetary policy, is
right.
to have 2% inflation and full employment. So they want to see that. For many years, we have not sort of seen much inflation year over year. So we kind of got used to like the value of today's dollar being worth a dollar tomorrow and next year. That's actually not what they want to do. Inflation shows economic progress and growth.
So is that because they want our dollar to be worth more against other currencies? No, it has nothing to do.
No,
why,
so it's just
so
a,
why would they want? That's just
part of the economic policy that,
okay.
that a small level of inflation, it shows growth, it shows positive things. So we want to have some inflation. So
okay.
the goal has been to have 2% inflation. Some years we've hit it, some years we haven't. So if we think about it, in some ways, the comparison from a year ago is a bit of a false narrative.
Right.
Because of the fact that we think about, what did you not do last summer? You probably didn't go on vacation.
You didn't fly. You didn't stay in hotels. You didn't eat out.
Right. I mean, so a lot of those things. So what we're seeing is catching up with that. So
really, we're getting almost 2 years in one.
Right. So, and also we think about it, like, I've gone to Cedar Point this summer. So like it is crazy busy because everybody is excited to do things outside and see people and do those activities. So we're getting that economic pressure on things. So what we're seeing is sort of catching up. So the position of the Federal Reserve as of right now is that they believe that this is a short-term function.
Right. It's going to even itself out. Right.
Right. Exactly. So that if everybody wants to go on vacation this summer, kids are going to go back to school in the fall. So like those things are going to drop off.
Right.
We don't have any promises of that, but we have reason to believe that this is a short-lived function.
Okay. So then, because one of my whole things when I'm looking at this and on my soapbox, I'm sort of like, well, wait a minute. We're trying to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour.
But some people are, not everyone.
But if we raise the minimum wage, but everything is costing more, then doesn't that just really cancel out getting more money?
No, that's not exactly how it works. Oh. So really what it is, when we think about the raise that you could get out of this deal, does that mean that there are going to be some inflationary pressures? Absolutely. But remember that the market is still working to provide you with the most value for your dollar.
Okay.
So is there the likelihood of that? Absolutely. But it's not going to be an exact trade-off. So if you're making $7.25 an hour, we bring it up to a $15 minimum wage, you're not going to see 100% inflation.
Right. Okay.
So there is still going to be a factor. And notice that also we have not raised the minimum wage, and inflation is still happening.
Right.
So those are two different measures that are going on, and we don't want to conflate the two.
And is that why typically when they say, like, when they're going to raise Social Security or, you know, for at like 2%, because they think that's the average cost of living, you know, increase.
Mm-hmm.
So that's really that adjustment for that inflation.
Right.
So really, if you're at $7.25 and you're going to get to $15, that's double, but you're only going to, out of that 50%, so you're going to get a 48% bump.
Right, exactly. Okay. So that's one of those things where you have to think about it on those. So they are looking at, for inflation, they purchase, the basket of goods is like 80,000 things.
Oh.
You're not buying 80,000 items
every month. But didn't it used to be like a small amount?
I don't know what it is, but like that's what they, I mean, so it's a broad section of the economy.
Okay.
So you can yourself buffer yourself against inflationary pressures by not buying some of those things or substituting. So maybe that you're seeing the price of airline tickets go up, so you decide to drive.
Right.
Well, so gas prices have gone up, but that's not the same level.
Right, or at the same rate.
Right, or maybe you just say, we're going to do a staycation instead of traveling out west.
But you also have the issue then with housing, like some people, because the market is crazy, that people can sell their house, but they don't necessarily can afford to buy a new house.
Right, and so then there's also the question, are there a lot of people who are sitting on their houses who would be selling but know that the market is so tight that they're not going to, so that natural shift in the market also creates it. So we have curious, I'll just call them curious market conditions right now. And really we have no guidance as to how this is going to play out because we haven't been through it. So if we think about sort of the Great Recession, we didn't know what that was going to look like. We survived it. Some people did better than others, but we came out on the other side. We're going to come out on the other side. We just don't have a really good model to be able to say, okay, when this happened last time, we don't have a last time.
Well, but the difference is because of the fact that when it was a housing bubble, it was just focused on housing. because of the pandemic and everything, it's the entire, you know, economy. So you don't know what's going to happen.
So the Great Recession was actually based on factors from the financial markets and from banking and things like that. This is a totally different beast.
Because this is really coming from Main Street, right?
Versus Wall Street. There's lots of things. So there's supply chain problems. I mean, so if we think about all the pickup trucks and parking lots of like waiting for the microchips so they can sell.
Right, because that was the issues when we had the tariffs and things with China.
And just like supply chains and lots. I mean,
and people aren't making things. They stopped making.
And then also there's been a challenge for the fact that we know that the economy in many ways has recovered faster than was anticipated.
Right.
And so some of the supply chains of like you weren't ramping up for things because you thought it was going to be kind of looking more like 2020 than 2019. So this is kind of a gigantic mess. And so we're putting together things as best we can, but there's really, we don't know what the future is going to hold.
Well, I want to thank you for really making numbers really interesting. And I think that, you know, our time really went by. But now I'm going to shift it where this is not based on facts and numbers.
Okay.
Because at the end of each And Good Company program, I ask guests the same 12 questions that French novelist Marcel Proust popularized from a Victorian parlor game. So there's no facts or figures here. And there's you can't make any pros and con lists, okay? What is your favorite word?
Delight.
What is your least favorite word?
I don't have one.
Really?
No.
What turns you on creatively, spiritually, or emotionally?
I do a lot of cooking.
What turns you off creatively, spiritually, or emotionally?
Annoying things.
That's your list of annoying things, right? Mm-hmm. What sound or noise do you love?
Oh, the sound of water.
What sound or noise do you hate?
Anything that's rattling in my car. I will stop the car and rearrange it.
What profession other than your own would you like to attempt? Now, we also have to add that in addition to the director of the community research, you are also an attorney.
Yes.
So, okay.
Yeah, so if I had the abilities, I would have like wanted to be a professional musician, but that left long ago. So,
what profession would you not like to do? An attorney.
No, anything that probably would be outside. I'm not really an outside person.
What do you consider your greatest achievement?
Going to law school and passing the bar.
Who, living or dead, would you most like to have a conversation with?
Oh gosh, Barack Obama.
How would you like to die?
Peacefully and fast.
If heaven exists, what would you like to hear God say when you arrive at the pearly gates?
You've done a good job.
And I want to thank you that you did a really good job of helping me on my soapbox of getting people to really understand this issue of cost of living in Fort Wayne and that it's not as significant as people would think.
Yes.
And I want to invite you back as soon as you get some of the U.S. Census numbers for 2020 to come back and share what it means for all, because this is the big Census Bureau research for 10 years that's going to set a lot of precedent in policy and politics. So I do want you to come back.
Yes.
And I will hold that space for you.
Excellent.
And you can learn more about And Good Company and all the other great conversations we have had at andgoodcompany.info. And we look forward to next week when you can again enjoy a seat at the table for great conversation and good company.